I'm sitting on the stage, Ed, looking out at where Skipper Joe Irwin's schooner is riding at her mooring. And looking at her, I've noticed how she's always on the move, swinging this way and that with the tide and the baffles of offshore wind from the hills, falling back till her chain brings up taut, then shooting ahead to slacken it. Always and forever on the move. A stranger, not knowing the difference, would think she was gone adrift. That is, if he didn't know about her chain and her anchor and her holding ground. And a thought struck me. How much that schooner is like us people along this part of the Newfoundland coast, and most likely like people everywhere. Oh, we have our little baffles of wind and tide, differences of opinion on a good many things that swing us different ways. A stranger might think we was gone adrift. That is, until he knew about our moorings and our olden ground. Oh, it is funny, the thoughts that'll run through an old fisherman's head. And another funny thing, you find a thought in your head and you wonder how it got there and what led up to it. Now, what in the world made me get to comparing people with Skipper Joe's schooner? Oh, yes, I remember. I started by thinking about the job I've got to do tomorrow. And that, of course, led me to thinking about Michael. About Michael and me and the holding ground. Michael. It's 1 year ago this very evening since he landed here in the mailboat from the steamer. I didn't see him that first day, because I'd gone in over the hill with me trout pole. Oh, I heard the steamer blow all right, but it never dawned on me that a visitor would be on her. And besides, the trout was biting. The upshot was that the first I heard about it was from Lizzie. Now, Lizzie's my missus, though everybody calls her Grandma Walcott, just as they call me Grandpa. She was waiting for me with the news when I got home.
Is that you, Ben?
Yes, my dear.
I wish you'd have come home a bit earlier.
But I couldn't. Should have trout don't start biting proper till almost dark.
I get so worried about you in there by yourself. Suppose you had an accident or a sick turn or something.
No, nothing no good ever comes to any harm. And besides, look at the fine gather trout I got.
Oh, my dear lovely ones. Now wash up and eat.
I'll take a few over to Sophie's for her breakfast.
Yes, they'll come in handy. She got a boarder. Come on the steamer this evening.
Oh? Who is he?
I don't know. 'Twas Emma Jane Battle that looked in and told me.
Did she say what he looked like?
No, except that he was tall, with a dark suit, dark coat, dark hat, and a dark muffler round his neck.
Muffler? This time of the year?
Yes, Emma Jane figured he didn't look well.
But Lizzie, didn't you see him at all?
No.
Well, that's a funny thing, when he had to pass right by the kitchen window on his way up the hill.
I must have dozed off. Now eat your supper.
Thank you, my dear.
What a Skipper Joe wear one. Good evening, Skipper Joe.
Evening, Grandma. Grandpa. Oh, sorry, I didn't know you was having supper.
Oh, that's all right, Joey boy. Sit in and have some.
No, Grandpa. Thank you all the same. Had mine an hour ago. How was the trouble?
Oh, middling, Joe, middling. Got a fry and a few for Sophie besides. Yeah. Going to take him over in a minute. Give me a chance to meet the stranger.
Well, it won't do you no good. I just come from there.
Why won't it do me no good?
He's gone to bed.
gone to bed this hour. What's the matter with Neddy sociable?
No, it is not that. And Sophie says he looked tired. Went to bed without his supper, like he wasn't a well man. I thought the same when I took his suitcase on the wharf. Why, he could hardly straighten up with it. But when I took it, it was no heavier than a bucket of water.
But he's a big fellow, though, according to reports.
Oh, yes, tall and broad. A big frame, but not much meat on it. Like I say, a big man, but not a well man.
Hmm. Perhaps he's broke down and come here for a rest. How long is he stopping?
Only until the steamer comes back from the Nore tomorrow evening.
Only 24 hours. Poor boy. He won't rest up much in that time.
Now, Joe, who is he and where is he from?
I don't know, Grandpa.
Oh, he didn't Soph tell you?
No, she don't know neither.
Well, didn't she ask him?
No.
Why in the world didn't she? She should have had that much pumped out of him before he was in the house 5 minutes. What's coming over Sophie?
Sophie says he's not the kind of a man that you pumps. She said there's something about him that puzzles her.
Puzzles her?
Yeah, and it puzzled me too when I brought him up here this evening.
Well, maybe he's stuck up.
No, it is not that.
Standoffish?
No, nor that neither. Like I say, it puzzles me.
Well, it is not going to puzzle me. I'm going over to Soph's and find out the rights about him now.
Oh, now, Ben, you do nothing of the kind. Clocking around Sophie's house, disturbing the poor man when he wants his rest. Take off your boots.
Besides, Grandpa, you'll have lots of chances to find out all about it tomorrow.
Why? How?
Well, and Sophie says he asked her to engage a boat for him.
Oh?
He wants somebody to take him in boat for a few hours.
All right, Joey, me boy. You take him out.
Oh, no. He made a special point of it that he wants the oldest man he can get. And that's you.
Wonder what he wants.
Well, I don't know. Maybe he's one of them writer fellas. You know, the kind that goes back and writes about us quaint and backward people.
No, I've never seen him. But from what I've heard already, I'd say he was more respectable than that. Anyway, Ben, you'll get a chance to find out for tomorrow.
Sophie's packing a lunch basket for the two of you. She says to be sure and take a kettle, in case he feels like going ashore to boil up.
Yes, Ben. And take care of that man. Take the oil coat for him, in case it turns wet. And a bearskin rug. It gets air some these evenings. Joe?
Yes, Grandma.
Perhaps you'd pass these few trout into Sophie's on your way along.
Yes, and tell her I'll be over in the morning.
Mother beauties.
Oh, and Joe.
Yes, Grandpa.
Do it quiet. Maybe he's gone to sleep, resting up for tomorrow.
Well, that's disturbing. Well, good night.
Good night, Skipper Joe.
Oh, and Joe.
Yes.
Just in case I'm not back in time tomorrow, don't forget to hoist the flag for the lodge meeting tomorrow night.
Oh, I'll remember. I suppose you'd be back in time for lodge.
Oh, bound to be. I got to be back in time for the man to catch the steamer anyway.
That's right. Well, good night again.
Good night, Skipper Joe.
Grandma took it easy next morning, and it was nearly 8 o'clock before I lighted the fire, got me kettle boiling, took a cup of tea into Lizzie. She's poorly nowadays since the summers are chillier than they used to be. Then I fried me trout, ate me breakfast, and went down to take me boat off her collar. Oh, lovely morning, but just a draft of sou'westerly and one or two crews already in from hauling their cod traps. I got the boat ready and sat down to watch for Sophie's signal. I was on my second pipeful when she came out on her doorstep to shake out her tablecloth.
Oh, good morning, Sophie. Good morning.
Good morning, Father.
Good morning.
This is the gentleman you're going to take out and vote.
How do you
do,
sir?
Father, sir.
How do you do?
Well, we certainly got a grand day for it. Certainly glad to be able to take you out, sir.
Thank you very much.
Now, Father, here's the lunch basket.
Oh, thank you, Toby.
Oh, dear, I forgot the kettle. I'll run right in and get it.
Troy got one down aboard.
You're not giving the gentleman tea out of that dirty old smoked up one. I'll get the clean one. Sure, the tea would taste more like bark than tea. I'll get that clean one.
Boy, oh boy, the women. They think just because a kettle is seasoned good proper, it oughtn't to be used. We'll take hers along, but we'll use ours.
Now, sir, I take it you're a stranger in these parts?
I have never been here before.
Any of your folks live around here?
No.
Oh, any acquaintances like?
None.
You wouldn't be one of them writer fellas, would you?
Writer fellows? Oh, no, no.
Did you have a good night's sleep, sir?
Yes, I did indeed. The best for a long time. It was so quiet.
And your breakfast, sir. Did you like the trout?
They were delicious. Your daughter told me you caught them.
Oh, yes, indeed I did.
Now, Father, here's the kettle. Make sure you grease the bottom of them before you put them on fire.
Oh, sure.
Where did you catch them? The trout, I mean.
Oh, just in over the hill. Not 5 minutes' walk.
Not 5 minutes' walk. How I wish...
You wish what, sir?
No matter. There won't be time.
But we got a long day ahead of us, sir.
Yes, but there's so much to do in just one day.
Oh. Well, we might as well be on our way, yes.
Joe, any fish this morning?
Oh, about 2 kettles. Got everything you need.
Oh, yes, Joey, boy. Everything.
Oh, no, I haven't. I forgot the bear skin.
Oh, hold on.
I forget my head server wasn't fastened on.
I'll run up and get them. I won't be a minute.
Oh, so do, Joe. And Joe.
Yes.
Close the back door quiet. Grandma might be dozed off. Now, sir, my name is Ben. Ben Walcott, though most people hereabouts calls me Grandpa, but you can call me Ben if you like.
Yes, Ben.
And now, sir?
Yes, Ben?
If I might make so bold, sir, what would I be calling you?
Oh, you may call me Michael.
Michael. Ah, that's fine. Now we're shipmates, Ben and Michael. Well, Mike, me boy, there's the mouth of the harbour. Any place you'd like to go special, or is one place same as another?
When we get out there, Ben, I'll want you to turn north. Let me see. There's the sun. About southeast. That means we'll be heading east then. So we'll turn sharply left. Or should I say hard aport?
Hard aport will be, my boy. I should have known all along that you was a seaman.
Seaman?
Yes. Ain't you?
Why, no.
Never been?
No, never.
A fisherman, then?
No.
Never in your life?
No, never.
Oh. Well, heading north will bring us right straight for Hartley's Harbour.
Hartley's Harbour? How far away is that, then?
Oh, 6 miles down the shore. Down that way.
Isn't there some place nearer than that?
No, that's the nearest. Hartley's Harbour, 6 miles.
But isn't there some place between Hartley's Harbour and Pigeon Inlet?
No.
Ben, are you sure?
Certain sure, sir. Why, I've lived here all my life, nigh on 80 years. I ought to know.
Strange.
Just a minute.
Yes?
You wouldn't be thinking about... But no, of course you wouldn't.
Thinking about what, Ben?
Well, there used to be a place between here and Hartley's Harbour, but it's not there now.
Why? What happened to it?
Well, most of the folks went away, and them that didn't died until there's no one left. I remember the night they waked poor old Paddy Muldoon. He was the last.
That would be Muldoon's Cove. Ben, I want to visit Muldoon's Cove.
But Ben, boy, you can't. There's nobody there.
Still, I'd like to go there. Do you mind, Ben?
Oh, not a bit. Only, like I say, you won't find anybody there. And besides, there's a tricky place getting in and out of. All shoal water, muddy bottom, capy rocks and mussel beds.
But you know your way in and out, don't you, Ben?
Oh, sure. Been in and out hundreds of times.
Well, then let's go there.
Oh, and another thing.
Yes?
There's not enough water getting in and out at low tide.
Well, how's the tide now?
Oh, she's about half down. If we goes in there this morning, we'll have to bide 5 or 6 hours till it rises again.
Still, I'd like to go there, Ben.
Okay, shipmate. Where's that Joe with the bearskin? Oh, we'll know when Muldoon's Cove is coming open, all right, because there's an old pine tree right on the cliff on the back of it, and an old house on the beach right in under the pine tree.
Would that be the house of the man you mentioned, the last man who lived there?
Yeah. Paddy Muldoon's and his father's before him. Nigh on 100 years old. The last one standing.
Ben, I'll want to do something when we get near Muldoon's Cove.
What, Michael?
I'll want to take the tiller, Ben. I want to steer her in.
But, Michael, you can't. You run her aground.
Not if I keep Muldoon's house right in line with that tree on top of the cliff.
How in the world is she not?
And at half tide, I'll have 4 feet of water under her keel all the way in. Won't I, shipmate?
Michael.
Yes?
You say you've never been here before?
That's right, Ben.
Does that mean Muldoon's Cove, too?
I give you my word, Ben. I've never seen Muldoon's Cove before. I'm now visiting Newfoundland for the first time.
Well, sir, no matter who you are or what you are, you'll take the tiller, sir.
Michael.
You'll take the tiller, Michael. Ah, here's Joe with the bearskin.
Here you are, Grandpa.
Thank you, boy.
Hope I didn't keep you waiting.
No, that's all right.
Now, can I help you put the stuff aboard?
Yes, boy, thank you. And he took her in, straight as a die, with rocks almost scraping on both sides. He kept the rooftop of Muldoon's house dead in line with the old pine tree on the cliff. And the look on his face, and his steady grip on the tiller told me something. Maybe he hadn't been here before. Not with his body, that is. But he'd been here thousands of times. In his mind.
You say, Ben, that the Muldoons lived here and the Cassidys lived across the cove? Were these the only families?
Yes, except in the Shanahans.
Oh, yes, the Shanahans. And where did they live, Ben?
Oh, just up the drogue a piece. You can see where the alders have all grown up. Would you like to go up?
Yes, Ben, in a minute. But first, tell me something about these people, these Muldoons and Cassidys and Shanahans.
Well, Michael, I'll tell you the best I can. You see, years before I was born, these three families came from a place across the ocean that they talked about and sung about called County Galway. They found this little cove and settled in it. They fished only because they had to. But they'd loved the soil, and they'd cleared every bit of it right from Muldoon's Cove clear up to Shanahan's Ridge. Then, for 2 generations, they thrived. But then there wasn't enough land to divide among the boys, and the maidens had to leave to find life partners. The first to go, Fergus Shanahan, who about my own age, left here with his wife Maggie O'Rourke nigh on 60 years ago to go to America. And then down the years, the rest of the Cassidys all left or died. And all the Shanahans and the rest of the Muldoons, except Uncle Paddy and Aunt Bridget. Now, they're gone too.
Ben, did any of you people ever meet up with them after these that went away?
No, except once when Jonathan Briggs was in a place called Toronto and happened to run into Terry Cassidy. Terry kept him for hours, talking about Hartley's Harbour and Muldoon's Cove and Pigeon Inlet and wanting to know all the news about Uncle Paddy and Aunt Bridget. But you're going to find it queer what I'm going to say now, Michael.
Say it anyway, Ben.
Well, Jonathan Briggs told me that right there in the middle of Toronto, Terry Cassidy sounded like a man that was lonesome and homesick.
That doesn't sound strange, Ben. I can easily believe it.
We have a saying, you know, Michael. We old fishermen in the Newfoundland bays. A saying that relates to people who leave and go to bigger cities.
What is it, Ben, the saying?
Well, it's this. We say you can take the man out of the bay, but you can't take the bay out of the man. It means...
I know exactly what it means, Ben. Shalem non animum mutant, qui transmere corant.
What kind of talk is that, Michael? That's not English.
No, Ben, it isn't English. As a matter of fact, the man who first said those words didn't know any English. But when he said them, I believe he must have been feeling very much as Terry Cassidy was feeling in Toronto. Or as I'm feeling now.
Say it again, Michael.
Shalem non animum mutant, qui transmere corant.
Oh, it sounds like poetry when you say it.
It is poetry, Ben. But what you said was poetry, too.
Me? Said poetry?
Yes, Ben. Listen, two lines of poetry. Shalem non animum mutant, qui transmere corant. You can take the man from the bay, but you can't take the bay from the man.
Yes, but what does the first line mean, Michael?
Exactly the same as the second line, Ben. But now, let's go look at the cemetery in the chapel, and the place where the Shanahans lived.
Okay, Brighton, boy. Up this way.
I notice the cemetery fence is kept in very good condition, Ben.
Yes, Uncle Paddy looked after it the best he could while he was alive.
And since then?
Well, the truth is, Michael, I've been coming down myself, off and on, to keep an eye on it.
Ben?
Yes, Michael?
Will you continue to keep an eye on it?
Sure I will.
Thank you, Ben.
Well, there's not a trace of the old chapel left. But we older fellas remember where the built-up end of it used to be. And there's where the Shanahans had their place. There's nothing left of that either, except a bit of the rock wall that Ferg Shanahan's house stood on. Well, we kept looking at that for a few minutes, and once I got the crazy notion that there was something glistening on Michael's cheek. But when I looked again, it was gone. And besides, there wasn't a falter in his speech. And what would a man like Michael find in Muldoon's Cove to affect him anyway?
You mentioned a Shanahan, Ben. The one who went away first.
Oh, yes, Ferg Shanahan. The one who married Maggie O'Rourke from down the shore. Same place my Mrs. Lizzie come from. Oh, we met him one year when we was down there fishing. They was good friends, and so was me and Ferg.
You say you and Fergus fished together?
Yes, and we ate together and we slept together. Boy, we done everything together.
Except pray together?
Oh, we prayed together indeed, so we did. Especially one night that I remember.
Prayed together where, Ben?
On an ice pan it was, 4 miles off Artley's Harbour Point, way out that way. The swiles was in, and we two buckos was too far out when the wind shifted. We got cut off from the crowd and was adrift on the pan all night. Bad night, too. Nor-west wind and snow.
But the two of you were together, Ben?
Yes. And lucky thing for me that we was. I slipped off the pan during the night, but Ferg hauled me back on again. Oh, big fella Ferg was. About your size. And he took off his own mackinaw and wrapped it around me like a blanket. Lucky thing for me, he had 2 pairs of socks on his feet, too.
Why, Ben?
Why? Because he made me take off me wet ones and put on one pair of his dry ones in their place. Too big they was. But me feet didn't freeze.
How were you rescued, Ben?
Well, everybody come looking for us the next morning. But it was old Martin Cassidy and Uncle Fanny Muldoon got to us first. Just in time, too. The ice pan had broke up a lot during the night. Being a morning, it was nothing but a clumper, liable to roll over any minute. Oh, myself and Ferg learned something about prayers that morning, I can tell you.
What did you learn, Ben?
Well, Michael, you know how some people think that you can only pray from your heart when you're kneeling on your knees?
Yes.
Well, they're wrong. You can pray from your heart when you're lying on a slippery ice clumper with your fingers dug into a crevice and praying that she won't roll over any minute while a boat is coming from a mile away. Myself and Ferg prayed together, all right. The same as we done everything else together.
Didn't you ever hear of him after he left, Ben?
Well, his wife, Maggie, used to write to Lizzie, but, oh, she must have died 40 years ago.
46 years ago, last March.
Yeah, 46 years ago last March, like I said. But I'll bet you that neither Ferg nor Maggie, while they lived, ever forgot us people down here.
No, Ben. Shalem non animum mutant.
Wait a minute, Michael. Let me finish it. You say the first line again.
Shalem non animum mutant.
Qui trans mare curunt. You can take the man from the bay.
But you can't take the bay from the man.
There you are. We both learned something this morning. Well, let's see what Soph got in the lunch basket.
Ben, it seems almost a pity to disturb Sophie's lunch.
Oh, so that's what it's for. And besides, we got to eat.
Ben, I wish I had thought of something, but it's too late now.
What, Michael?
Mussels.
Mussels?
Yes, Ben, mussels. What about mussels?
Well, there's plenty of them out there. But what do you mean, what about them?
They're good to eat, aren't they?
Sure, anybody that likes them.
Don't you like them, Ben?
Me? Sure I do.
Did you and Ferg ever eat them together?
Yes, hundreds of times. When we was boys, we'd eat them right out of the shells.
Isn't there a right time in the month for them, Ben?
Yes, when the moon is full. The same as it is now.
And with the tide just beginning to rise.
Yes, by golly, Michael. Cooked in their shells, in their own salt water, dipped up on a rising tide.
Well then, Ben, we should have cooked some.
Ah, we'll take some back to Sophie. She'll do them up in the oven with breadcrumbs and cheese. You like them better that way. You've had them before, huh?
No, never, Ben. But if you and Ferg Shanahan ate them out of their shells, why couldn't you and I do the same?
Blessed if I see any reason why not. You bide here a few minutes and I'll go down and dip up a kettle for them.
No, Ben, there won't be time.
Oh. Well, we have to come back another day.
How I wish we could.
Well, Fergie boy.
Yes, Ben?
Michael.
Yes, Ben?
I called you Fergie.
That's all right, Ben.
But you answered just the same as if your name was Fergie.
But it is my name. Michael Fergus, to be exact. Call me Fergie if you wish.
No, I won't. I daren't. Because looking at you sitting there with a bit of colour back in your cheeks and a twinkle in your eye, I thought for a minute that you was... But you're not 80 years old, are you?
Goodness no, Ben. I'm not 60.
Of course not. I should have known better. But I'm not going to call you Fergie anymore. And now, Michael boy, I'll be back to light me pipe.
Ben, I wish you'd tell me more about the people who lived here.
Oh, I could tell you plenty. Especially about Paddy Muldoon. There's some crackerjack yarns told about Uncle Paddy, I could tell you.
Tell me one, Ben.
Well, I could tell you about the one where the bull moose chased Uncle Paddy across Gullmesh.
Yes?
Yes. Gullmesh is just up behind the hill there. 2 miles across it is from the edge of the cliff to the timber. With not a stick nor a tree for the whole 2 miles. Nothing but bog and moss.
Yes, and the moose?
Oh, yes, the moose. Well, one day about 2 years before he died, Uncle Paddy took his breech loader in across the bog to the timber in the hope of finding a partridge or a rabbit or something like that. And the first thing he knew when he was in among this clump of hollers was this thing staring him straight in the face. Not half a gunshot away.
The moose?
Yes, the biggest moose he'd ever laid eyes on or ever heard tell of. And without thinking, Uncle Paddy up with the gun and let him have it. Of course, all he'd done to the moose was make him mad. So he'd give a snort and come for Uncle Paddy like the chain lightning.
And what did Uncle Paddy do, Ben?
Well, he got out of that clump of ballers in a hurry, I can tell you, and headed straight for home, 2 miles across Gullmish, with the bull moose still half a gunshot astern of him. Uncle Paddy looked back one time, but what he see didn't look so good. So he hove away his gun and settled down to run for his life.
And he kept ahead, Ben?
Yes, all the way across the mesh. And lucky for him that the mesh was pro solid too, so he made good headway. But then, just as he was over almost home, he thought of something.
What?
Well, here he was, headed for the edge of the cliff, right behind us there, and no chance to alter his course.
What?
So there he was, with a 200-foot drop ahead of him, and no chance to slow down. And then he thought of something.
He thought of what?
The old pine tree on the edge of the cliff there. The trouble was, the lowest limb on the tree was a good 15 feet above the ground. But that was his only chance, to head for that limb and jump. If he missed it, he was finished. So, he kept on running until he got on underneath the limb and he jumped for it.
He grabbed the limb, of course.
No, he didn't. He missed it.
Missed it? But Ben, you said this happened years before he died.
He missed it on the way up. But Michael...
Yes?
He grabbed it on the way down. Yes, and that moose went along and under like something shot out of a gun. When Uncle Paddy got down to it, it weighed 1,100 pounds.
So it was a good supply of meat, Ben.
Yes, and Uncle Paddy, not having a moose license, wired to the ranger to find out what he'd do with all the meat. And the ranger wired back and told Uncle Paddy to divide the moose equally among all the poor people of Muldoon's Cove. So Uncle Paddy and Aunt Bridget had 500 pounds apiece.
Whatever did they do with it all, Ben?
Well, I tell you, it was cut and come again all winter for whoever minded to drop in. Then when the spring come, Aunt Biddy did what was left up in some screw top bottles. We ate the last bottle the night Uncle Paddy was waked, 2 years later.
Ben, you mentioned Uncle Paddy's wife. Who was she before she married him?
Oh, Aunt Biddy, she was a Shanahan, a Ferg sister, and the kindest woman that ever lived.
Tell me more about her, Ben.
Well, you know something about the good book, Michael.
Yes, I ought to.
And about what it says of the reward given for the cup of water given in the spirit of kindness?
Yes.
Well, I suppose the same thing applies to a cup of tea.
Yes, Ben, I should think it would.
Well, then, Aunt Biddy got enough rewards coming to her to fill the hole of Joe Irwin's schooner. Living in a sort of halfway place, the cups of tea she'd give away would float Joe's schooner anyway.
Yes, she was hospitable, Ben, wasn't
she? Indeed, she was. But here's the funny thing. It was her very hospitality that got her into trouble with the law. The first time I ever remember the law having to come to Muldoon's Cove.
Ben, certainly she didn't get into trouble with the law for giving away cups of tea.
No. 'Twas mugs of blackcurrant juice. But would you like to hear the whole story?
Yes, indeed, Ben, I certainly would.
So I told it, and as I did, it seemed as if me mind took me back 18 year. And I was there again in the little courthouse in Atlee's Harbour with the magistrate, Skipper Bob Killick, on the bench. Constable Jenkins, the policeman, a severe-looking man if ever there was one, Aunt Biddy sitting to one side, and Uncle Paddy standing up facing Skipper Bob.
Order! Order in the court! Order to be upstanding! Be seated.
Now, Patrick Muldoon, as you know, you're charged with the illegal possession of alcoholic liquor.
What an unchristian name to put on a drop of old berry juice.
This drop of berry juice, as I've heard it called, appears to contain 38% by volume, according to the report of the analyst as submitted to the court by Constable Jenkins. Do you wish to question him?
Yes, Skipper Bob. I mean, Your Honor. This 30... What was it you said?
38%.
Do that mean too strong?
Yes.
Well then, Skipper, excuse me, Your Honor, you can blame it on the Redway's ready relief.
Blame it on the what?
The ready relief, Your Honor. 'Twas a Redway's bottle that the policeman put the little sample in to send away to the authorities.
Constable, was it a Redway's bottle you used?
I didn't notice, Your Honor.
But I did, Your Honor. And it's my opinion there are a drop of berry juice has taken the blame for the strength of the Redway's ready relief.
I rinsed it good before I sent it, Your Honor.
Yes, but the strength of that stuff, Your...
Order. In any case, Mr. Muldoon, I think it's a different kind of strength that the analyst refers to. Have you anything else to say, Mr. Muldoon?
No, Your Honor.
Oh, Paddy, Paddy, tell him about your stomach trouble.
Order there. Order in court.
Mr. Muldoon, is it your wish to tell the court about your,
His stomach trouble, Your Honor.
No, Your Honor.
Well, then I'd like to tell about it.
Now, Biddy, Biddy, darling.
Very well, then, Mrs. Muldoon. Considering the close relationship between you and the defendant, the court feels that you should be given every opportunity to give the background to this case. You may sit down, Mr. Muldoon. Now, Mrs. Muldoon, first of all, what do you mean by referring to this alcoholic liquor as a drop of old berry juice?
Because that's all it is, Your Honor. You see, when the Cassidys and the Shanahans and the Muldoons, all of us lived in the cove, well, each family had his own garden, and each garden had rows and rows of blackcurrant bushes. We used to send them up and down the coast every year by the 22-pound tubful. But then, when there was only Paddy and myself left, we had more than we knew what to do with. You don't like to see things going to waste, do you, Your Honor?
No.
And no more do I, Your Honor. So that's why I'd pick up the ones that had fallen on the ground, and I'd put them in a barrel. And then to keep them from drying up, I'd add some water and a few other things. And I'd let them bide there.
Water and a few other things? You had a recipe?
Oh, yes, Your Honor. Indeed, I did. A recipe that my dear grandmother, Molly Shanahan, God rest her, brought with her from County Galway and gave it to me before she died.
'Twas an old recipe.
Old? Why, Your Honor, 'tis said that the Shanahan menfolk used it for snake bite. Now, that must have been a long time ago, before the blessed sage himself drove the slithery things out of Galway.
Yeah, but what use did you have for this snake bite remedy?
Me, Your Honor? None at all. Nor Paddy, neither. Not in the matter of snake bite. We used it for medicine.
Oh?
Yes, Your Honor, which brings me to the subject of Paddy's stomach trouble.
Biddy, Biddy, darling.
Order there.
Yes, Mrs. Muldoon, getting back to the subject of Paddy's stomach trouble.
Oh, my, Your Honor, he suffers terrible from it. And he always says that a pint mug full of this juice gives him blessed relief.
Yes, but what effect did a pint mug of this medicine have on Mr. Muldoon? Apart, of course, from relieving his stomach trouble.
None at all, Your Honor. Except for his fiddle.
Except for his fiddle? Yes, continue, Mrs. Muldoon.
Well, Your Honor, you see, there we'd be in the long winter evenings, Paddy and myself. And I'd say to him, Paddy, I'd say, take down your fiddle and play us a little of the music of old County Galway. And he'd say, Biddy, darling, I would, only I got another touch of the stomach trouble. So, Your Honor, I'd draw him off a mug full of this berry juice, sometimes two, until he got blessed relief. And then he'd take the fiddle, and he'd play the music of old County Galway that'd bring tears into my eyes, into his own, too. And what I can't understand, Your Honor, is why the authorities should be down and petty about it.
Did you ever give any of this medicine to anybody besides Mr. Muldoon?
Oh, no, Your Honor, never. Except once or twice, and then only to relieve pain.
Biddy, darling.
Order.
Tell me about this once or twice.
Well, it was one night there was a wedding on down in Harkness Harbour. And Obadiah Grimes and a few of them come to my door and asked me if I had a drop of anything to give them for the wedding. Of course, Your Honor, I told them I didn't, that I wouldn't have the like of it in my house, and that apart from some water, I had nothing but this old drop of berry juice.
And did they want any of that?
Oh, at first they did, Your Honor. But when I explained that it was only good as a medicine for stomach trouble, they went away again. But about an hour later, Obadiah Grimes come back.
Oh, he did?
Yes, Your Honor. He was all doubled up in pain.
And what was wrong with him?
Stomach trouble, Your Honor. And was he suffering? It took 3 or 4 mouthfuls before he was properly aised. And then, when he was afraid he'd get another attack in the middle of the night, I drew him off the port bottle full to take home with him.
And he left, still standing upright?
Oh, yes, Your Honor. I can prove he did.
How?
Because I heard afterwards that he made a show of himself that night at the wedding. And his wife Jemima was all upset over it.
You don't think his behavior had any connection with this berry juice?
Oh, no, Your Honor. It never affected Paddy that way. And now, Your Honor.
Yes?
About the recipe.
Oh, yes, the recipe.
It's likely to die with me, seeing as how I got no women folk to leave it to before I go.
Oh, I imagine it's still preserved among the other Shanahans back in County Galway.
Your Honor, did I do wrong in not giving that recipe to the constable when he asked for it?
Constable! Did you?
Your Honor, a matter of evidence, you see, Your Honor.
Yes, I think I see. No, Mrs. Muldoon, you didn't do any wrong. You don't have to give that recipe to anybody.
Oh, but I'd give it to Your Honor, gladly.
Will you indeed, Mrs. Muldoon? I mean, no thank you, Mrs. Muldoon. Even the magistrate needs to pray not to be led into temptation. And now stand aside while I deliver judgment on Patrick Muldoon.
Don't be hard on him, Your Honor. He's all I got.
I'll take your plea into consideration. And now, Patrick.
Your stand.
The court finds you guilty of the illegal possession of what the law in its wisdom calls alcoholic liquor. And the penalty in such cases, made and provided, is that you serve a term of not less than 7 days in jail, or pay a fine of not less than $10. Now, there are a number of things I can do. I can send you to 7 days, and with the jail almost 100 miles up the shore, there's a reasonable chance of getting you there before your term expired. Or I could sentence you to a longer term, and thereby penalize you for not anticipating the law and moving your residence near to the jailhouse. Well, I'm not impressed by either the wisdom of the one course or the justice of the other. So, Patrick, let's consider the matter of the $10 fine.
Of course, Your Honor. Cash is out of the question.
I understand.
A few bags of cobblers later in a fall, Your Honor. Or a few 22-pound tubs of black currants next summer.
Now, what have you got to take that the court can take to sell and raise the money?
Well, I'd like to help you out, Skipper Bob, Your Honor. But I'm blessed if I can think of anything except me horse, me punt.
You need your punt to make your living. What about your horse?
Yes, you can take me horse and welcome.
Is she in good condition?
The best, Your Honor. Not a wobble, neither one of the 4 legs.
Is she good for woods work?
That's all I ever used it for, Your Honor.
Well, then, that's how we settle it. Constable, you're to take Mr. Muldoon's horse, sell it to some one of the wood contractors, retain $10, and give Mr. Muldoon what's left over.
But, Your Honor...
Yes, Constable?
He ain't got our...
Oh, you have so, Your Honor. The constable saw it in the backyard. He's been lying here for 50 years.
Your wood arf?
Yes. And what other horse do you think I was talking about, you fool?
Order, order. Well, I conclude by judgment. Far be it from me to question the wisdom of those who make our laws and set minimum fines and jail terms. And further be it from me to anticipate the outcome of any subsequent action the Supreme Court may take on the verdict I am about to pronounce. But this I must say, to wit, the court derives no pleasure from the prospect of the Muldoon household being afflicted with stomach trouble, and thereby being deprived of hearing the music of old County Galway. I might inject here that since the Killicks came from County Antrim, I won't be accused by the Supreme Court of showing favoritism. So let's put it this way. Mrs. Muldoon, if you must have medicine for stomach trouble in your home, see to it that it's administered to the inpatients only. On no account are you to conduct an outpatient's department. And Mrs. Muldoon?
Yes, Your Honor.
Whatever you do, don't operate a traveling clinic. Sentence is suspended.
Order! Order in the court!
And mighty boy, that's the way it ended.
I certainly would have liked to have met Skipper Bob.
Well, you won't. Not now. Not in this world.
But they found out afterwards who it was that informed on the Muldoons.
How, Ben?
Well, it was the next fall, when Uncle Paddy was laid up with a twisted ankle and Aunt Biddy had the flu at the same time.
What happened then?
Well, everybody wanted to help. But it was Aunt Jemima Grimes that took charge. She made Obe keep him in firewood all that winter, and she herself bided down there until Biddy was better. Of course, Aunt Bridget tried to thank her, but Aunt Jemima said she owed the Muldoons more than she'd ever be able to repay.
I wonder whatever happened to that recipe, Ben.
I imagine it's still the secret of the Shanahan women back in County Galway. But what time is it, Michael? You're getting cold.
Yeah, it's past five, Ben. Time to be getting back.
Yes. Oh, if the tide's in now. I was afraid of that.
Afraid of what, Ben?
The wind's in from the eastward. We'll ship a bit of water on the way home, but nothing to hurt. But a wetting won't do you any good.
No, it has turned chilly.
I think we'd better run before it into Hartley's Harbour. You can catch the steamer there the same as in Pigeon Inlet.
But what about you, Ben?
Oh, I'll phone Lizzie and tell her I'm in Hartley's Harbour. All right.
But what about your meeting tonight?
They can do without me for one night.
No, Ben, don't miss it. Let's go home.
All right. But when you get down in the boat, you sit up forward and put this oil's skin on you and wrap this bear skin around your knees to keep yourself warm.
But, Ben, I can't take your coat.
Nonsense, Michael. I took a man's mackinaw one night on an ice pan, remember?
This time, you take the tiller, shipmate.
Okay, shipmate. Well, Michael, that lunch certainly tasted good, didn't it?
Yes, Ben, it certainly did.
It wasn't too bad going home. Just a dirty windlap and a drop of spray back in the stern. But the main thing was, I kept Michael dry and got him home with plenty of time to spare before the steamer was due or the lads meeting either. After he went in, Soph come out to tell me what she'd been wanting to tell me earlier that morning. And a fine time she picked to tell me that he was a clergyman. Yes, she'd noticed his collar that morning at breakfast time before he dressed up with the scarf around his neck. Of all things, a clergyman. Well, that flustered me. What in the world did he think of me? Here I'd been all day calling him by name just like he was an ordinary man. And the things I'd said. All right for one fisherman to say them to another. But to a clergyman. My, oh my. Well, if that flustered me, how do you think I felt when I got home and found Lizzie, my own wife, looking and acting as if she was cracked?
Ben! Ben! Oh, Ben!
Lizzie, my dear, what's the matter?
Oh, Ben! Ben, how can I tell you?
Tell me what?
Oh, Ben, I've seen a vision.
You've seen a what?
I've seen a vision. I've seen Maggie O'Rourke. She that I grew up with. And that married Virg Shanahan the day that I married you. And that, oh, Ben, that's been dead these 45 years. I've seen her today.
You've seen her? Seen her where?
Coming up the path with you a few minutes ago.
Now, Lizzie, my dear, calm down, calm down. That was no Maggie O'Rourke or any other Maggie. That was a man. And a real man, too.
But, Ben, what's his name?
His name is Michael, and I just found...
Michael! Ben, please run back to Sophie's and ask him isn't his name Michael Shanahan.
I'll do better than that. I'll ask him isn't his name Michael Fergus Shanahan. Boy, dear.
Oh, Ben, did you see him?
Yes, my dear. And he's eating his supper with the best appetite he's had in years. He's Michael Fergus Shanahan, all right. Clergyman and all. And he's not a bit vexed with me for not knowing it.
But, Ben, did you ask him about me?
Yes, and he seems to know all about you, too. Wanted to know if you wasn't Lizzie Marshall that was from Marshall's Harbour.
Oh, he is Maggie's son. He must be. And, Ben, is he coming over to see me?
Well, I says to him, says I, will I tell me missus that your reverence will be coming over to see her?
And, Ben, what did he say?
He said no.
Oh.
Yes, and there he comes.
Hello, Aunt Lizzie.
Hello, Michael.
And how are you today, Aunt Lizzie?
Oh, poorly, Michael, poorly. Nothing serious. It's just that the summers are not what they used to be.
Indeed, they're not, Aunt Lizzie.
No. Here it is 3 more days to the middle of July, and the evenings are still airsome. But we'll get warmer soon, and I'll be able to get out and help Ben around the garden.
Yes, I'm sure you will.
And thank God I can still hobble around the house and get Ben's meals. Poor Ben. I'm afraid I'm not the help to him that I ought to be.
Now, what's that kind of talk, Grandma?
But enough about my troubles, Michael. Tell me about yourself. You weren't even born when dear Maggie and Fergus went away. But Maggie was expecting. She told me. We used to tell each other everything.
You were good friends, weren't you?
Ah, yes. We grew up together down in Marshall's Harbour. Always together in our waking hours. Except, of course, on Sundays, when she'd go to Mass and I'd go to prayers. And whoever was out first to wait for the other one. Ah, these were the times.
And then, Aunt Lizzie?
And then? And then came the summer when Ben was fishing down Marshall's Harbour. 2 summers later, me and Maggie come back here with him, married. My Sophie was born the following July. And Maggie was expecting when she went away in August. She was hoping for a boy. She was gonna call him Michael.
And she did.
Ah, Michael, what a stock you sprung from. With the smile in the eyes of Maggie O'Rourke and the frame of Fergus Shanahan. What a man you are. And Michael, I see you picked a good calling, my son. A good calling. Did Maggie know before she died that you were going to do it?
Yes.
And Fergus, is he?
20 years ago.
Oh. There's something of Maggie's that I'd like to show you. Something that you've never seen. And it's here in this house.
What is it?
Over there on the window. In the flower pot.
What a lovely flower. A begonia, isn't it?
A begonia it is. And well nigh as lovely as her that owned it, nigh on 60 years ago.
Maggie?
Bless your heart, yes. The day before she and Fergus went away, she came up to see me where I was confined with Sophie, being only 10 days old. Lizzie, darling, she says, take this flower and keep it alive. 60 years. It'll live as long as I will.
I didn't know a flower could live so long.
Ah, yes, Michael, if it's cared for properly. I've watered it every day, changed the earth on it every spring, and taken a new slip off before ever the old stem could die. Michael?
Yes?
Let you and me water it.
I'd love to.
Well, then we'll do it. Ben, fetch me a jug full of water. The little luster jug, Ben, dear. Thank you, dear. Now, Michael, you pour some, and I'll pour some. No, no, not there on the top. Pour it into the dish at the bottom.
Oh, I see. You water it from the bottom?
Always. And the lampwick carries the water up through the hole in the bottom of the pot. Just moisten the dish, and the wick will do the rest.
There. Is that enough?
That's your part. Now, I'll pour a drop or two on for good measure. Oh, Ben, dear, hand over the scissors. Now, Michael, there's one other thing. You take the scissors. Open them. Now, hold them just below the joint on that little branch. Not too close. That's it. Now snip.
There you are. I've done it. What next?
Stand the little branch in the jug with the water we didn't use.
Thank you, Michael. In a few days now, I'll plant that slip. And there'll be two pots and two begonias in the window. You see, dear, there's no longer just Maggie. There's Maggie and Michael. We did it just in time. And you must go.
Yes.
God bless you, Michael.
And you, Aunt Lizzie. Remember me in your prayers.
Indeed, I will.
Now I must say goodbye to Sophie. She was very kind.
And I'll go over and get your suitcase. Oh, there's Skipper Joe. What's all the guns firing for, Joe? Is the Federal member aboard the steamer, or have the tours come in?
Neither, that we know for. But there's got around that Ferg Shanahan's son is here, and we're giving him a Newfoundland send-off. We didn't have long enough notice to be large. Be you Ferg's son, sir?
Yes, Joe.
Well, well, well. And you can't stay? We'd like to have got to know you better, sir. We're awful sorry.
I'm sorry too, Joe. Tell them God bless them all.
And a few minutes later, he was heading for the mailboat, smiling and waving goodbye to the crowd on the wharf. We watched aboard the steamer, and watched the steamer till she went around the point.
Grandpa, mark my words. We've seen him for the first and last times.
Oh, I don't know, Joe.
Grandpa, I've been thinking. I'm a year older than him, and I've been through plenty of hardship and hard times.
Yes, Joe.
But the minute I laid eyes on that man, I could see he was through more hardship than I've ever been through. And it shortened his days.
But he didn't mention any hardship.
No, he wouldn't.
Well, after that, things on Pigeon Inlet went on as much as usual. Lizzie had two begonia plants to tend instead of one. Then one day, a Tuesday it was, the first flower bloomed on Michael's plant. I was almost as excited as she was, although I wouldn't let on. I told her she was fussing more than when Soph's daughter Suze was born. Then, about 2 weeks later, the letter come.
Look, Lizzie, my dear, got a letter from the post office.
My, our pension checks have come early this month.
No, don't look like that kind of an envelope.
Oh, who's it for? You or me?
Looks like it's addressed to both of us. Here, we'll open it and you read it. There's your glasses. Well, read it, come on. Well, ain't you going to read it? Is it from Michael?
No.
Is it about Michael?
Yes.
Oh.
The flower's beautiful, isn't it, Ben?
Lovely, my dear.
I'll read the letter. Dear Mr. and Mrs. Walker, this is to inform you regretfully that His Excellency Bishop Michael Fergus Shanahan passed away 3 days ago. His passing was not unexpected. He had never fully recovered from his harrowing experiences in the Far Eastern prison camp. And he was happy to have fulfilled a long cherished hope by visiting you before the end came. He left two personal messages for me to send to you. They were to
Well, Lizzie, I believe our begonias blossomed. To Uncle Ben. Here, Ben, I can't read this part.
Don't matter, my dear. I know what it says. Chalum non animum mutant, qui transmere curunt.
Well, Ben, I believe that's what it reads like. But how?
That's his password, my dear. His and mine. The same as the begonia. Yours and his. So he's gone.
Yes, Ben.
A far eastern prison. Oh, the miserable heathens, they shortened his days.
Hush, Ben, don't say that. They didn't know him like we did, or they wouldn't have done it to him.
No, that's right. But what was it the letter called Michael?
Bishop Michael Fergus Shanahan.
Oh, a bishop. And I didn't know.
I know, by the purple under his collar.
Oh, you should have told me, my dear. So I could have respected him more.
Oh, you couldn't have been. Nor loved him more, neither.
No, that's right.
Ben.
Yes, my dear?
He passed away Wednesday, week before last.
Yes.
The begonia. His and mine.
Yes, what about it?
Oh, Ben, it flowered the day before.
Oh, and now a year is gone, and like I said, I'm sitting on the stage head, looking at Skipper Joe Irwin's schooner, and thinking. Thinking about how weak are the things that try to pull men apart. Differences in colour, creeds and opinions. Weak things like the ripples tugging at the schooner's chain. And thinking about how strong are the things that hold men together. Strong. Like Joe's anchor and chain and the good holding ground below. Why, in Pigeon Inlet, we got things that are stronger even than dying. The things that brought Michael back from a heathen prison to eat mussels on Muldoon's cold beach. The things that are taking me tomorrow to put a lick of paint on the fence around the graves of the Cassidys, the Muldoons, and the Shanahans. Oh, but I'm getting too old to be going away alone. I need somebody with me, for company, and to do it after I'm gone.
Oh, good evening, Skipper Joe.
Evening, Grandpa.
Just looking at your schooner there, swinging this way and that. Never seems to keep still. It looks almost like she's adrift.
Nah, good holding ground there. Besides, there's not in a schooner's nature to keep still. Save when she's high and dry, rotting on the beach.
Oh, you busy tomorrow, Joe?
Oh, not very. We got one trap up, and the crew can handle what we're likely to get in the other. Why?
I was wondering if you'd come down to Muldoon's Cove with me.
Tomorrow?
Yes. It's a year ago since I was down there last, and I thought it was about time to go down again. Have a look at the place. You know, a lick of paint here and there and a paling off or two.
Sure, I'll come. I'll be glad to.
But now, Joe, I got something to show you. I was thinking about tacking that piece of board to the cemetery fence.
That's a nice piece of pine. Well, you painted it black, Grandpa, with white lettering on it. It says... Here, I can't read this stuff.
Oh, I believe it's Latin, Joe.
Oh, that's a horse of a different colour.
Why, Joe?
Where did you get it from?
Oh, Bishop Michael gave it to me when he was down last year. And then it was in a letter that come addressed to us after he died. I copied out the letters and painted them on the board. I thought it'd be nice to tack onto the cemetery fence.
Still, I don't know as I approve of this Latin stuff. Do you know what it means?
It says, et chalum non animum mutant, qui transmere curunt.
Yes, but what do it mean, Grandpa?
It means you can take the man out of the bay, but you can't take the bay out of the man.
Grandpa?
Yes, Joe?
Was you thinking about nailing that pine to the fence?
Yes, why?
Pity to use nails on a good pine. I'll bring along some brass screws, just the right length. Keep it up longer, too.
Well, what time do we go tomorrow?
Oh, early, Joe. Early. And don't forget the lads' meeting tomorrow night.
Oh, I'll hoist the flag before we go. Well, I must be getting home, I suppose. Awful chilly for this time of the year.
Yes, another 2 or 3 days and be the middle of July.
Yeah, summers are not like they used to be, right? No. Well, so long.
So long, Joe boy.